For sports fans, a new truth has dawned. It's a Saudi world we're living in now.
2023 is the year when Saudi Arabia's grand sports project went into overdrive. It has upended global golf and is in the process of doing the same with professional football.
Last season, 2022-23, the country's Pro Football League ranked a lowly 20th in terms of global expenditure on players when compared to other leagues. But this year, it has spectacularly skyrocketed to number 2, with clubs in Saudi Arabia forking out well over $1 billion to bring stars to the league.
What I think is really interesting about Saudi Arabia is this is sport policy and sport strategy, arguably, like we've never seen before.
In this episode, we'll ask what Saudi Arabia hopes to gain from its massive sports bet.
They want to reorient the economy so that it's not just reliant on oil anymore.
Why buying sports teams is important to the Saudi government and to the public investment fund is not about its international reputation, but really more about domestic constituents.
And we look in depth at accusations that Saudi Arabia is trying to distract us from unpalatable truths about the country and its leader.
What we're seeing is an open attempt to rehabilitate totalitarian dictator. You know, this is a man who imposes torture and execution on his people, where he denies them basic civil rights and freedoms.
In the case of Saudi Arabia, the abuses are particularly egregious, and the amount of investment is absolutely enormous.
Welcome to the latest episode of Business Beyond.
Saudi Arabia has invested so much, so quickly across a range of sports that it's hard to keep track. Here's a quick overview.
Saudi Arabia is estimated to have spent at least $6.3 billion on sports deals since 2021. The true figure is likely much higher as there is limited financial transparency. Football is the biggest outlay. The Saudi Pro League spent more than $1 billion this year on transfers alone, while Saudi Arabia bought English Premier League club Newcastle United for $380 million in 2021 through its sovereign wealth fund. That club has since spent around $500 million on players. Then there's golf. Saudi Arabia has pumped well over $1 billion into LIV Golf since 2021, set up to rival the long-established PGA Tour. And there are several other investments, from bringing large boxing events to Saudi Arabia, to Formula One motor racing, to cricket, tennis, and a range of other sporting investments at home and abroad.
So that's what they've been doing. But how have they been doing it? Here's a term you'll need to remember when it comes to Saudi Arabia and sport. The Public Investment Fund, commonly known as the PIF.
The PIF is Saudi Arabia's sovereign wealth fund. It's one of the largest in the world, with assets expected to exceed $1 trillion by 2025. It's the investment vehicle that bought Newcastle United. It also funded the establishment of LIV Golf. And in June, the PIF announced it had taken direct control of 4 clubs in the Saudi Pro League: Al Ahly, Al Ittihad, Al Hilal and Al Nasser. No surprise that those are the clubs who've been doing all the spending on some of the world's most famous footballers in the past few months. And who controls the PIF as chair? That's the same man who controls Saudi Arabia itself, Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman.
That's a key point to remember about the Saudi sports project. It's entirely state-driven, centrally controlled by bin Salman. All authority ultimately rests with the Crown Prince, and every part is linked. But why is Saudi Arabia doing all of this? To help answer that, we need to talk about bin Salman.
After his father, King Salman, came to the throne in 2015, bin Salman, often called MBS, was quickly promoted as heir apparent. He's widely seen as the de facto ruler. He presents himself as a reformer and regularly talks up his ambitions for the country.
I believe that the war is the new era.
We had the shift in power to King Salman, in the past decade. And he pretty quickly had his son, very young son in his 30s, Mohammed bin Salman, effectively take power within the kingdom. And he has instituted a new program or vision called the Vision 2030 program, which is basically like a map, roadmap for where he wants to see Saudi Arabia go.
Vision 2030. Get used to hearing that phrase. It's the grand date on the horizon when the kingdom will supposedly be transformed into a new economy and a new society.
From a major tourism campaign fronted by the world's greatest footballer, Lionel Messi, who they couldn't convince to come to their league, to ads promoting the not-yet-built but much-hyped futuristic city of Neom, Saudi Arabia is very much trying to sell an idea to the world about itself and what it believes it will become.
He's undertaking a complete reorientation of Saudi Arabia from what you could see as sort of a religious political economy, where they still had religious police that were able to enforce gender segregation within the country. They want to basically make it a much more inviting place to come. They want to reorient the economy so that it's not just reliant on oil anymore, or this orientation more towards global Muslims, and really be a part of the global conversation.
Economic transformation has been a constant theme for bin Salman. And the sports project, despite all the attention, is quite a small part of a much bigger operation.
The Saudi economy is still very much an oil revenue-based economy, has been for a long time. There are tremendous efforts underway at diversification, but that, you know, is a process over decades, not something that happens overnight.
That's Karen Young from Columbia University, an expert on economics in the Middle East.
So the Vision 2030 program is a government a sort of state planning mechanism to encourage investment into non-oil sectors, to try to create new sectors from nothing. So manufacturing sectors, a defense industry, tourism, entertainment, and really trying to also increase mobility among Saudi citizens, especially women.
Economic diversification. Because ultimately, that's what Vision 2030 is all about, making the economy less dependent on the product everyone associates it with. Saudi Arabia is the world's top oil exporter and is consistently one of the top three producers in the world, alongside the USA and Russia. Its economy remains heavily dependent on oil. Oil accounted for almost half its total GDP in 2022. Services were 36%. That includes government services and the tourism and hospitality sectors. But the kingdom's aim of growing non-oil sector revenues is gaining traction, as these figures from recent months show.
Saudi Arabia is not going to run out of oil anytime soon. But the need to diversify its economy is obvious, and the urgency of the green transition makes it even more apparent.
Once you get to 2045 and you know, cities across the world have got electric cars, you know, there's a lot of renewable energy being channeled into houses, supplied into houses and into commercial properties, then Saudi Arabia's economy begins to take a hit. And so what Saudi Arabia has to do is to diversify its economy by 2045. So it's got 20 years effectively to be able to do that.
The Saudi sports investments have been grabbing headlines, but diversification covers a range of projects.
When you think of the mandate of the PIF, which is to create more investment into the domestic economy, to create jobs for Saudi citizens, to diversify away from oil, sports and entertainment is one part of that, but there's a whole lot of other sectors which the fund is investing in. And so that allocation, especially of buying a sports team, it's actually comparatively small compared to what's needed to build out, say, a hydrogen sector, a green hydrogen sector, or to build out a new mining sector. Those sectors are going to require a whole lot more capital.
But that doesn't dilute the importance of sport in bin Salman's vision for Saudi Arabia.
You can see how sport can be very helpful to the kingdom. You know, if they jump in right away to some of these sports, especially like soccer, football, of course, which has this incredible global audience, then they can make a really big splash and change the way that people perceive the kingdom and start to find a new way to invite people into this new ambitious program that they have going on within both the politics and the economy.
along with a sustained investment in tourism, it's part of the Saudi plan to build a diverse services sector, which both boosts domestic consumption and, crucially, international reputation.
I think it's more a picture of trying to use this new openness to broaden out the kind of things that you know Saudi Arabia for. So I think that's why it's very important for them to move into sports, moving into entertainment as well. That provides a new kind of public life within the kingdom, a new way to see the kingdom that sees the kingdom as more inviting for a global public that will then want to move there, in fact, and be part of the new project of Saudi Arabia.
As much as this whole project is about moving away from oil, you can't overstate how much profits from oil, particularly over the last 2 years, have made all of this possible. While revenues dropped sharply at Saudi state oil company Saudi Aramco during the first year of the pandemic in 2020, they have boomed since. The firm took in more than $500 billion in 2022 as oil prices surged. Of that, a massive $161 billion was profit, the largest ever annual profit recorded by an oil and gas company. And that has directly fueled the Saudi investment binge. In 2022 and 2023, Saudi Arabia transferred 8% of Saudi Aramco shares directly to its public investment fund.
That shows the incredible financial muscle the Saudis have to operate with. But there's a whole other side to this story. A vast array of critics say that what Saudi Arabia is doing with sports is a blatant attempt to distract us from the things they would rather we didn't associate with the country.
And Saudi Arabia has lots of things it would like us to forget all about. This seemingly innocuous footage shows the Saudi journalist Jamal Khashoggi walking into the Saudi consulate in Istanbul on October 2nd, 2018. He was there to pick up documents to get married, but he was brutally murdered within minutes of entering the building by agents of the Saudi state. A respected columnist with the Washington Post, Khashoggi was a prominent critic of the lack of free speech in Saudi Arabia under bin Salman. US and Turkish intelligence agencies say bin Salman directly ordered the murder.
The murder of Jamal Khashoggi demonstrated not only just the brutality of the Saudi government under MBS, but it also demonstrated the complete lack of accountability and justice that proceeded from that murder. There was a huge amount of attention in the aftermath of the murder, and Western states and, you know, allies of Saudi Arabia did, you know, say that they were going to pressure and pursue, you know, justice and accountability, and yet none of that materialized.
The murder did lead to a serious, but ultimately short-lived chill in relations between Saudi Arabia and its Western allies.
Since energy price pressures caused by the war in Ukraine forced an American re-embrace of bin Salman, his own reputation has gradually been restored, further helped along by the glow of association with elite sports.
If we look at the Saudi purchase of Newcastle, you know, the expenditure on high-profile players as well to the Saudi League, you know, what we're seeing is an open attempt to rehabilitate totalitarian dictator. You know, this is a man who imposes torture and execution on his people, where he denies them basic civil rights and freedoms, who has been accused by the UN and by the US government of being responsible for the murder and dismemberment of a critic.
Human rights experts say that bin Salman's image in some quarters as a reformer belies the reality of life under his rule in the absolute monarchy that is Saudi Arabia.
Since coming to power in 2015, Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman has overseen one of the worst periods for human rights in Saudi Arabia's modern history. He has overseen a brutal crackdown on peaceful opponents, on civil society activists, on women's rights activists, subjecting these people to enforced disappearance, arbitrary detention, torture and ill treatment while detained. The use of the death penalty has also skyrocketed.
Human Rights Watch also points to Saudi Arabia's actions during the war in Yemen.
Over the course of the brutal war in Yemen, the Saudi-led coalition has been credibly accused of war crimes, insofar as they have targeted civilians and civilian infrastructure. Saudi Arabia has also been targeting migrants who've attempted to cross the border between Yemen and Saudi Arabia. We documented Saudi border guards shooting en masse at migrants attempting to cross, women and children, and the use of explosive weapons against migrants and asylum seekers seeking to cross into Saudi Arabia. Now, if these crimes were part of a deliberate Saudi policy to kill migrants, they may amount to crimes against humanity.
We contacted both the Saudi government and the Public Investment Fund for this video, but they did not agree to an interview. We particularly wanted to ask them how they respond to accusations that what Saudi Arabia is doing with sport is part of a sustained sports washing campaign aimed at cleaning up the country's reputation as a haven of inequality and oppression.
Sports washing is a relatively new word, but it's certainly not a new concept. It's a term used to describe the practice of individuals, businesses, or governments using sports to improve their reputation, particularly in the face of severe wrongdoing.
Sport washing is managing image, managing reputation, cleansing the image, cleansing the reputation that you might have through sport. But I guess if you go through to 1936, the Olympics in Berlin, we know that essentially what Hitler was doing through the 1936 Olympic Games in Berlin was to legitimize who he was and what he was doing. And you know, absolutely it was deliberate and it was strategic. And we know that in some cases it worked, in other cases it absolutely didn't work.
There's a wide range of views regarding whether what Saudi Arabia is doing is sports washing. Many are in no doubt.
Mohammed bin Salman has invested billions of dollars in large-scale entertainment and sporting initiatives as part of a deliberate effort to deflect from the country's terrible human rights record.
There's nothing particularly kind of subtle about how this works. The impact is immediate and extraordinary. And from a business perspective, despite their global fame, most football clubs are actually fairly small. The cost of buying them is relatively minimal. Newcastle is only a few hundred million pounds. And the outsized kind of cultural and news impact you get of that the tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of people spread your message online, and the way that just filters into the culture generally, it's an extraordinarily effective way of changing the world's view of you, even if it doesn't necessarily change everybody's mind.
Others take a more nuanced view.
I can understand the claims of sports washing. It's a moral claim. It's a moral argument that's put forth. And I think it does have some grounding. But I think it's important to understand that Saudi's ambitions go much beyond that, they're really trying to reshape the kingdom internally, reshape the world, the way the world sees it.
When Saudi citizens turn on the television and watch an international sporting event and see a Saudi brand name on a jersey or know that there's a connection, that means something, I think, to Saudi citizens who want to be more connected to the world, who see their country as sort of in this coming out phase of, you know, being more integrated into the global economy, being more accepted. That's something that matters a lot to the leadership of the country, and I think matters to this, you know, demographic, which is a very young population. So I actually think it's less to do with an international brand and more to do with the perception of Saudi citizens have of themselves.
This is a story that has just as much to do with the changing face of the commercial landscape of sport as it does with Saudi Arabia.
We really weren't expecting Saudi Arabia and Qatar and China and Russia and others to begin investing heavily in football in the way that they have. And I would characterize this as being geopolitical, but we're all now confronted with this new geopolitical reality. And for me, it's almost as though football has become an ideological battlefield.
If this is true, is there an argument that Saudi Arabia, which does have a relatively strong domestic interest in sport, is just as entitled to its piece of the action as anyone else?
People think, you know, this is about the international perception, when actually you need to be thinking, well, actually it's about what Saudis want, and it's what Saudis want to see of themselves. So maybe it's a little bit less about us and more about them.
those who are focused on Saudi Arabia's human rights violations say there is a need to remind sports fans of what they are signing up to.
It's hugely important for the viewers and the fans who watch these sports and who love these sports to be aware of the egregious violations that are happening both at home in Saudi Arabia and abroad.
But for bin Salman, there are plenty of reasons to believe that the grand plan is already working.
Clearly, sport in that context is a very powerful instrument. It's a very, very powerful way of attempting to shape narrative about a country.
Saudi Arabia is playing the long game, and it's only just begun.
That's all for now on Business Beyond. If you liked this video, there's a good chance you'll like some of our others. You'll find them in our playlist. Thanks a lot for watching, and until the next time, take care.